Welcome to The Needle, your Division I college basketball podcast. I'm Jack Williams, owner and operator of D1CoachCorner.com, your source for college basketball news, rankings, and predictions. On this podcast, we will present to you weekly conversations on D1 college basketball coaches and their teams. Don't forget to go right now on your computer, phone, or tablet and follow us on Twitter. This episode of The Needle is brought to you by D1CoachCorner.com. Your source for Division I college basketball.
Thank you once again for joining us on this show. Again, my name is Jack Williams, owner and operator of D1CoachCorner.com, your source for college basketball news, rankings, and predictions. Today, we're going to reveal who's on our hot seat watch list. Now, that doesn't mean that we have any information on the coaches that's on this list. These are just a list of coaches who we are watching and could possibly end up on the hot seat sooner or later. Now, on the top of our hot seat watch list was Coach Steve Alford. We announced that Coach Steve Alford was on our hot seat watch list on episode 5. He was fired in the middle of the season on December 31st, 2018, the first major firing for the 2018-2019 season. Coach Steve Alford was fired for too much inconsistency. UCLA is looking for a coach who can help the team to dominate the Pac-12. Steve Alford led the team to 3 straight Sweet 16 appearances, which may be pretty good for most teams, but not for UCLA, a team with deep traditions. UCLA doesn't like inconsistency. Ben Howland led the team to 3 straight Final Four appearances in 2006 through 2008, but after leading the team to the Final Four 3 years straight, he was still fired because he coached the team for 5 more years afterwards, but never returned to the Final Four. UCLA is a team with very high standards. 3 straight Sweet 16 appearances is not good enough. So with most major teams in college basketball, 2 losing seasons in 5 seasons is an automatic grounds for dismissal. No Final Four appearances in 5 seasons is also a grounds for dismissal with a high major team. For mid-major teams in Division I college basketball, a Sweet 16 appearance is gold. But 2 Sweet 16 appearances in 5 years for a coach in a mid-major equals a promotion to the majors. A coach who accomplishes 2 NCAA tournament appearances in a low mid-major team in Division I college basketball equals a promotion to a high mid-major team. And that's how the coaching carousel begins in college basketball. So with that said, who out of the major conferences on our hot seat watch list? One is Ernie Kent of Washington State, a mid-season coach who hasn't led the team to the NCAA tournament as of yet. As a matter of fact, Washington State has a place above 8th place under this coach and hasn't had a winning season as of yet. Washington State is currently 0-3 in the Pac-12 and has lost 6 games in a row. Now let's look at the history of Washington State. But as I said in episode 8, Washington State hasn't been in the NCAA tournament since 2008 under Coach Tony Bennett, who is now the coach at Virginia. Coach Ken Bone was given 5 seasons to try after that, but failed to do so. So what am I trying to say? What I'm trying to say is that Coach Ernie Kent's 5 years are up. Another coach that's on our hot seat watch list is Coach Danny Manning of Wake Forest, who is in his 5th season as head coach there. Coach Danny Manning has only had 1 overall win season under his belt, and that was in 2016 through 2017. Wake Forest lost in the first round of the NCAA tournament that season. Wake Forest is currently 0-3 in the ACC, and it looks as if they are on pace to have a winless season. But it doesn't matter if they have a winless season or not. It is almost certain that Wake Forest is going to finish in the basement of the ACC. For that reason, Danny Manning is more than likely on his way out the door. And notice that I said door instead of door, because you use door when you're about to kick somebody the hell out. So let's look at the history of Wake Forest. The previous coach, Coach Jeff Bezdelic, didn't even lead the team to the tournament. He resigned after 4 losing seasons in a row. He was smart enough to resign before getting the can in his 5th season. But before Jeff Bezdelic was Coach Dino Guardio, who actually led the team to the NCAA tournament 2 times in a row. Wake Forest was actually ranked number one for only the second time in team history in 2008 through 2009, only to be blown out by Cleveland State in the second round. So here's another thing that will get you fired in Division I college basketball. You have some coaches that will go out and recruit top recruits in the nation but has no experience coaching that caliber of player. Then they get this big buzz around the country, come out doing well, but lose in the first round of the NCAA tournament like Johnny Jones did at LSU with Ben Simmons. Now, I'm afraid that we're going to see that with Coach Penny Hardaway, who just recruited the number one player in the country, James Wiseman. Don't pick up a player like that if you have no experience coaching them. But Dino Guardio had a great team but came up short. But don't expect Danny Manning to be at Wake Forest for long. So who else? Coach Marvin Menzies of UNLV is also on our hot seat watch list. Why? As we've mentioned in episode 7, we thought that Coach Marvin Menzies was going to lead his 2017 through 2018 team to the NCAA tournament with players like Brandon McCoy, Javon Mooring, and Jordan Johnson on the roster. But what did we get? A 7th place finish in the Mountain West. Prior to that, an 11th place finish. And now, UNLV is losing games to teams like Indiana State and Valparaiso. Now, I had UNLV picked to finish 3rd in the Mountain West this season behind Boise State. A 3rd place finish will probably secure his job for the next few seasons because it means that his team is potentially getting better. But if UNLV places anywhere less than 3rd, his job may be in jeopardy next season. Keep in mind that Coach Menzies wasn't hired under the current athletic director. As we mentioned in episode 2 of our show, Marquette has a pretty good team this year and was picked to finish 2nd in the Big East according to the coaches poll. Coach Wojo is in his 5th season with Marquette and hasn't yet gotten the team past the first round of the NCAA tournament. Now we understand that Marquette is currently ranked at number 13 in the AP poll, but that doesn't get him out of the clear. A great season with an early tournament exit can become a problem for a coach in his 5th season without a deep run into the tournament. The biggest achievement so far in Coach Wojo's head coaching career at Marquette is a first round exit in the NCAA tournament. And so, in order for Coach Wojo to steer clear of any talk of a hot seat or firing, he is going to have a Sweet 16 finish or greater. Anything less than that can be a problem in the near future. Now, another coach is Jim Christian of Boston College. Now, Coach Steve Donahue was let go after just 4 seasons prior to Coach Jim Christian taking over the team. And Coach Donahue had at least 1 winning season in the ACC. Jim Christian has no winning seasons. And Boston College is currently 0-3 in the ACC Conference. Now, there are several mid-major teams who have been with their teams for at least 5 seasons or more who hasn't yet produced a win season. Among them are Jim Fox of Appalachian State. Coach Fox is in his 5th season at Appalachian State and hasn't yet produced a win season. Appalachian State is currently 0-4 for the season. Appalachian State finished 11th in the season in 16-17, and it looks like we're going to see a repeat of that season. If so, Coach Fox could probably be on his way out the door. Another one is Coach Corey Williams of Stetson. Coach Williams hasn't finished better than 7th place since taking over the team. But like I said before, to his defense, the Hatters have never won a conference regular season title or a conference tournament title since joining Division I basketball in 1972. However, that doesn't mean that they want to continue to lose. And at some point, this team is going to want to turn things around. Now, we also have Coach Pat Duquette of UMass Lowell. UMass Lowell classified to Division I in 2013 for the sole purpose of winning. However, they haven't had a winning season yet under Coach Pat Duquette. How many losing seasons is UMass Lowell going to allow before they give Coach Pat Duquette the can? Others to watch are Coach Anthony Latina of Sacred Heart, Coach Chris Casey of Niagara, Coach Russ Pennell of Central Arkansas, which all 3 of these are in their 5th season and has only 1 overall winning season. Then we have Coach Kareem Richardson of UMKC, and we have Coach Greg Herrenda of Fair Dickinson. Both of these are in their 6th season with only 1 overall winning season. Then we have Coach Murray Garvin of South Carolina State, who's in his 7th season and has only 1 overall win season. Then Coach Tommy Dempsey of Binghamton, who's in his 7th season and has no winning seasons in his conference. On another note, Indiana loses 4 games in a row, and that's definitely not good for Coach Archie Miller. And Coach Bryce Drew and Vanderbilt starts the SEC conference play out at 0-6, and that's definitely not good for Bryce Drew's coaching career. and so much for that. Now, let's take a look at Week 11 of college basketball and see which teams have moved the needle either up or down. On Sunday, January 13, 2019, Villanova picks up its third road win of the season by moving the needle upward by defeating Creighton at the C. Chai Health Center in Omaha. The win made Villanova 4-0 for the season. Creighton has to be very careful as the needle continues to move downward for this team, and we are approaching mid-season conference competition, the point of no return. The needle moves up greatly for Syracuse as it defeated number one Duke at the Cameron Indoor Stadium in Durham, North Carolina. Of course, this was a depleted Duke team, one without point guard Trey Jones and without Cam Reddish. But a win is a win, and Syracuse did what they were supposed to do. Beat them down while they're down. And Kansas hold down their spot at number 7 with a home win over Texas. And Maryland holds down their spot at number 17 with a home win over Wisconsin. Now, Nebraska moved the needle up significantly with this road win over a ranked Indiana. Nebraska received 36 votes in the AP Top 25 in Week 11 and should be ready to crack the Top 25 in Week 12. In the meanwhile, Indiana definitely falls out the Top 25 for Week 12 with their third loss in a row. Indiana seems to be struggling on the road, especially against quality teams. Now on Tuesday, January 14, 2019, both Nevada and Kentucky moved the needle up with road wins added to their resumes. Nevada barely squeaked through on the road against probably the second best team in the Mountain West, Boise State. So much for thinking that Nevada was going to have an easy time running through the Mountain West. On the other hand, Kentucky demolished Georgia with a 20-point win at the Stegman Coliseum in Athens, Georgia. Also on Tuesday, Marquette continues to move the needle up with its road win over Georgetown. Buffalo continues to sit in the middle of the top 25 with its road win over Western Michigan. Buffalo has been in the top 25 since week 2 of college basketball. Now, Iowa State looks to return to the top 25 after dropping out in week 11. Iowa State got a good road win over a ranked Texas Tech team. Look for Iowa State to return to the top 25 after this win. Kansas State should gather more votes towards the top 25 with its needle-moving win over a ranked Oklahoma. Houston and Iowa should hold both their spots in the top 25 with their wins on Wednesday. Houston defeated SMU on the road, while Iowa defeated Penn State on the road. South Carolina continues to inch the needle up with its road win over Vanderbilt on Wednesday. This team was a surprise to me. I surely thought that South Carolina was destined to sit at the bottom of the SEC this season. Instead, it's Vanderbilt who sits at the bottom. Coach Drew needs to find a way to stop the bleeding before things start to get very ugly in Vanderbilt. Now, Temple should also start seeing an increase in votes with its road win over East Carolina on Wednesday. Oregon should start seeing a few votes in the top 25 with this road win over Arizona. Prior to the win, Oregon appeared to be on pace to having a disappointing season. Now on Friday, January 18, 2019, Maryland won their seventh game in a row and their fourth road game of the season with a convincing win over a good Ohio State team. Maryland should definitely move the needle up for week 12 of the AP poll. I know Michigan and Michigan State are good, but don't count out Maryland. Now on Saturday, January 19th, we had a plethora of needle-moving games going on. First, Duke defended his home court against ranked Virginia. The win or loss does nothing to move the needle for this game. However, it secured both teams' position at the number one spot for Duke and the number four spot for Virginia. Both of these teams are fighting for number one seeds in the NCAA tournament. We also had an upset. Wisconsin beats Michigan at home. This loss would definitely send the needle ticking down for Michigan, but not by much. However, I expect Michigan to probably fall from the number two spot into like the number five spot. Keep in mind that this is another team playing for a number one seed in the NCAA tournament. The needle continues to tick downward for Texas Tech, who loses to a not-so-good Baylor team. Baylor is the second non-ranked team this week to have defeated Texas Tech. For that reason, Texas Tech should fall somewhere towards the middle of the AP Top 25. Now the needle also ticks downward for Kansas, who lost to a not-so-good West Virginia team this week. Expect Kansas to fall to the middle of the AP Top 25 as well. Great road win for Kentucky, who moves the needle significantly with a win over a ranked Auburn team. Expect the needle to move down for Auburn just a tick. North Carolina moves the needle up with a road win over Miami. This is North Carolina's fifth road win of the season. North Carolina currently sits in the number two place of the ACC. North Carolina State continues to impress with a road win over Notre Dame. This makes North Carolina State's second road win of the season. Expect the needle to move upward slightly for this team. And Texas, a team that's nowhere to be found on the AP Top 25, defeats a ranked Oklahoma team at home in Texas. Oklahoma should fall to a lower portion of the AP Top 25 in Week 12. Houston should remain in the center of the top 25 with this road win over South Florida. Houston has only one loss for the season, on the road against Temple. Houston should remain in the center of the top 25. Now Mississippi State gets a much needed road win over Vanderbilt. Mississippi State gets to remain in the top 25 for another week. As Vanderbilt is concerned, a 0-6 start for the season can't be good for Coach Bryce Drew. Now Indiana loses their fourth game in a row. They will definitely drop out of the top 25, and that can't be good for Coach Miller either. Now that concludes the needle moving portion of our show. We'll now move on to the new coach impact segment and the hot seat watch list portion of our show. This portion of our show is brought to you by D1CoachCorner.com, your source for college basketball news, rankings, and prediction. Once again, don't forget to go follow us on Twitter after the show at D1CoachCorner. In this new coach impact segment, we will be discussing coaches who have been head coach of a particular Division I basketball team for no more than 5 years and who are on the upward trend towards taking their teams to another level. This week's new coach impact highlights Coach Grant McCasland of North Texas. Coach McCasland is in his second season as head coach of North Texas and has this team playing at a very high level. North Texas won the College Basketball Invitational Championship, the CBI, in just his first season. North Texas is currently 4-1 in the Conference USA and is in position to compete for the conference regular season and tournament titles. Coach McCasland took over for Coach Tony Benford, who was fired for his inability to lead the team to a winning season in his 5 years as head coach. North Texas was only 2-16 in Coach Benford's final season. North Texas finished in 14th place in the Conference USA. North Texas continues to prove greatly under the leadership of Coach McCasland, however. Now on to our hot seat watch list. Our hot seat watch list highlights Division I head coaches who have, for the most part, been with their teams for 5 or more seasons, but hasn't produced a winning season or anything close to it, or a major Division I head coach who can't seem to get his team past the first round of the NCAA tournament. Not good. As mentioned before, hot seat watch list goes to Jim Fox of Appalachian State. Coach Fox is on his fifth season warning track at Appalachian State and hasn't yet produced a win season in the Sun Belt. Now, that concludes our show for this week. Join us next week at the same time and channel for new episodes. We'll be happy to take your questions and comments on Twitter for our next episode. Our Twitter handle is at D1CoachCorner. That is at D1CoachCorner. See you next week.